بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسوله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، جزاك الله خير for waiting. بارك الله فيكم. This is the last lesson from this book of Sheikh Salih Uthaymeen رحمه الله from the sittings of Ramadan. And this is the 30th sitting, المجلس الثلاثون في ختام الشهر. In the ending of the month of Ramadan. So I'm just going to begin now. Bismillah. Alhamdulillahi al-wasi al-azim al-jawad al-barri al-rahim khalaqa kulla shay' faqaddarah wa anzala al-shar'a fayassarahu wa huwa al-hakim al-alim bada al-khalqa wa anhaahu wa sayyar al-falaka wa ajrahu والشمس تجري لمستقر لها ذلك تقدير العزيز العليم والقمر قدرناه منازل حتى عاد كالأرجون القديم للشمس ينبغي لها أن تدرك القمر ولا الليل سابق النهار وكل في فلق يسبحون. So the Shaykh, he begins the introduction, praising all praise belongs to Allah, the all-encompassing, the great, the generous, the kind, the merciful, the one who created everything in its due proportion, and he revealed, he sent down his legislation, and he made it easy, and he's the all-wise, the all-knowing. And he began his creation, and he will bring it to an end. And he is the one who put the planets in orbit and made them run their trajectory. And the Sheikh, he mentions the course of the Quran ayah, and the sun runs on course towards its stopping point. That is the determination of the exalted in might, the knowing. And the moon, we have determined for it phases until it returns, appearing like the old day stalk. It is not allowable for the sun to reach the moon, nor does the night overtake the day, but each in an orbit. In an orbit, it is swimming. So then the Sheikh, he mentions, continue with this introduction. Ahmaduhu ala ma awla wa wahada. وأشكره على ما وحب وأعطى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا هو الملك العلي الأعلى الأول الذي ليس قبله شيء والآخر ليس بعده شيء الظاهر الذي ليس فوقه شيء والباطن الذي ليس دونه شيء وهو بكل شيء عليم وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله المصطفى على المرسلين صلى الله عليه وعلى صاحبه أبي بكر أفضل الصديقين وعلى أمر الخط وعلى الأمر المعروف بالقوة في الدين وعلى عثمان المقتول ظلما بأيدي المجرمين وعلى علي أقربهم نسبا على اليقين وعلى جميع آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما. So the Sheikh, he mentions here, I praise him, Allah, for his protection and guidance. I thank him for what he has bestowed and what he has given. I further bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped in truth but Allah alone, the King, the Most High. The first, there is nothing before him. The last, there is nothing after him. The most high, there is nothing above him. The most near, there is nothing nearer than him. And he is the knower of all things. And I bear witness that Muhammad is his slave and his chosen messenger over all the creatures. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And Abu Bakr, his companion, the best of the truthful ones. And Umar, the one who is known with strength in the religion. And Uthman, the one who was killed wrongfully by the hands of the criminals, and upon Ali, the closest one of them in kinship and in relation, and upon all his family, his companions, and whoever follows their footsteps till the day of judgment. Then the Sheikh he begins, Ikhwani, my brothers, إن الشهر رمضان قرب رحيله وعزف تحويله وإنه شاهد لكم أو عليكم بما أودعتموه من الأعمال فمن أوده عملا صالحا فليحمد الله على ذلك وليبشر بحسن الثواب فإن الله لا يضيع أجر من أحسن عملا ومن أوده عملا سيئا فليتوب إلى ربه توبة نصوحا فإن الله يتوب على من تاب ولقد شرع الله لكم في ختام شهركم عبادات تزيدكم من الله قربا وتزيد في إيمانكم قوة وفي سجل أعمالكم حسنات فشرع الله لكم زكاة الفطر وتقدم الكلام عليهم مفصلا وشرع لكم التكبير عند إكمال العدة من غروب الشمس ليلة العيد إلى صلاة العيد قال الله تعالى ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون وصفته أن يقول الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله والله أكبر والله أكبر الله أكبر ولله الحمد يسن جحر الرجال به في المساجد والأسواق والبيوت إعلانا بتعظيم الله وإظهارا لعبادته وشكره ويسر به النساء لأنهن مأمورات بالتستر والإسرار بالصوت ما أجمل حال الناس وهم يكبرون الله تعظيما وإجلالا في كل مكان عند انتهاء شهر صومهم يملأون الآفاق تكبيرا وتحميدا وتحليلا يرجون رحمة الله ويخافون عذابه شرع الله سبحانه لعباده صلاة العيد يوم العيد وهي من تمام ذكر الله عز وجل أمر الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بها أمته رجالا ونساء وأمره مطاعا لقوله تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول ولا تبطلوا أعمالكم وقد أمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم النساء أن يخرجن إلى صلاة العيد مع أن البيوت خير لهن فيما عدا هذه الصلاة. So just translating that now, the Sheikh he mentioned, my brothers, indeed the month is coming to an end and is departing and so it's coming to an end. And it will be this month will be it'll be a witness for you or against you for what you have deposited from it from actions. So whoever deposited righteous actions from this month, then praise Allah upon that, and you know rejoice for the great amount of reward that will be attained. Indeed, Allah does not waste away the reward for one who does righteous actions, and whoever deposited some evil actions, then upon him is to repent to Allah with a sincere repentance. So he makes sincere repentance because Allah he forgives whoever repents to him. And indeed Allah has legislated for you all in the end of this month acts of worship that increase in your nearness to Allah and increase in your faith and in your iman and strength and the scales of your righteous actions and deeds. So Allah he legislated for you all zakat al-fitr and the speech pertaining to that has preceded in the previous lessons about giving the zakat al-fitr, and Allah has legislated for you that you glorify Allah by completing about when the sun has set on this last day. Also today, when the sun sets on the night of Eid, because it becomes after Maghrib, it becomes the night of Eid. You start beginning with this takbir until the Salatul Eid. So until the prayer of Eid, you're going to begin with this takbir. And this is according to this proof that is mentioned by Allah. ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون. Surah Baqarah verse 185, where Allah says that you may complete your counting of the month and glorify Allah for guiding you, and that you may be grateful to Him. So and the description of what you say is as the following: Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Wallahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Walillahi alhamd. Yeah, so that is what we say, and which basically means Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest, none has the right to be worshipped but Him alone. Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest, to Allah belongs all praise. And it is a sunnah to do it loudly, openly, for the man in the masajid, in the masjid, and in the marketplaces, and in your houses, doing it openly to glorify Allah, and it's a worship that is, it's an apparent worship, something that is apparent, and that you're thanking Allah, and you're showing your happiness while you're thanking Allah. And for the women is for them to say in a low voice, for the women, so they make this zikr, but say it with a low voice, because they are commanded with concealing their voices, especially in front of males that are not related to them. So then the sheikh says, how great of a is the state of the people that they glorify Allah, glorifying Him and praising Him in every place until the end of the month of their fasting. Yeah, until the end of the month of them fasting, they glorify Allah, they fill the horizons with the glorification and praise, and saying La ilaha illallah. So with this, obviously, takbir will be Allahu Akbar, and tahmid is walillahi alhamd, and tahleel is La ilaha illallah. So they say this supplication, hoping for the mercy of Allah, and fearing His punishment. And Allah has legislated the Most High for them this worship, and also the worship of Salat al-Eid, the prayer of Eid, on the day of Eid, and it is from completing the remembrance of Allah the Most High, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded his nation with, from the men and the women, and he and that is with according to the speech of Allah, where Allah mentions, يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وَلَا تُبْتِلُوا أَعْمَالَكُمْ. And that Surah Muhammad verse 33, where Allah mentions here that all you who believe, obey Allah and obey the Messenger, and make not your deeds in vain, or work in vain. So here the Prophet commanded even the women to come out to the prayer, for the Eid prayer, and while the house is better for them, except for the prayers, except for this particular prayer, which is the Eid prayer. So it's better for them to pray in the deepest depths of their houses for the women, than to pray elsewhere in the masajid. Even though they are not stopped from entering the masajid, but it's better for them, in another narration that's mentioned. So here, Sheikh is referring to that, but except for this prayer, the women were commanded to come out to the musalla, to the open area for praying. And the Sheikh is going to go into that further. So وهذا دليل على تأكيدها. قالت أم عطية رضي الله عنها أمرنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن تخرجهن في الفطر والأضحى والأواتك والحيدة والذوات الخدور فأما الحيد فيعتزلن المصلى ويشهدن الخير ودعوة المسلمين قلت يا رسول الله اهدنا لا يكون لها جلباب قال لتلبسها أختها من جلبابها متفق عليه الجلباب لباس تلتحف فيه المرأة بمنزلة الإباء. So then the Sheikh he mentions that from among these recommended is the E that we mentioned. So here he mentions that the Messenger of Allah commanded the women to attend the Eid prayer, even the third best place we mentioned is their house. And Atiya, she mentioned, may Allah be pleased with her, the companions, she said, the Messenger of Allah commanded us to bring out on Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha young women who and hijab, observing older women and menstruating women. The menstruating women stayed out of actual prayer area but participated in good deeds and supplication. So she said, I, Atiya, said to the Prophet, O Messenger of Allah, one of the women does not have an outer garment. Yeah? He replied, let her sister cover her with her garment. So that is what the woman wears. So then the Sheikh mentions, وَمِنَ السُنَّةِ ومن السنة أن يأكل قبل الخروج إلى الصلاة في عيد الفطر تمرات وترا ثلاثا أو خمسا أو أكثر من ذلك يقطعها على وتر لقول أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يغدو يوم الفطر حتى يأكل التمرات ويأكلهن وترا رواه أحمد والبخاري ويخرج ماشيا لا راكبا إلا من أذن كعجز وبؤد لقول علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه من السنة أن يخرج إلى الإيد ماشيا رواه الترمذي وقال حديث حسن ويسن للرجال أن يتجمل ويلبس أحسن ثيابه لما فيه صحيح البخاري عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال أخذ عمر جبة من استبرق أي حرير تباع في السوق فأتى بها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال يا رسول الله ابتع هذه يعني اشترها تجمل بها لإيدي والوفود فقال له رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما هذه لباس من لا خلاق له وإنما قال ذلك لكونه حريرا ولا يجوز للرجل أن يلبس شيئا من الحرير أو شيئا من الذهب لأنهما حرام على ذكور من أمة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وأما المرأة فتخرج إلى الإيد لا تشبه وأما المرأة لا تخرج فلا تخرج إلى الإيد متجملة ولا متطيبة ولا متبرجة ولا سافرة لأنها مأمورة بتستر منحية عن التبرج بالزينة وعن التطيب حال الخروج ويؤدي الصلاة بخشوع وحضور قلب ويكثر من ذكر الله ودعائه ويرجو رحمته ويخاف عذابه ويتذكر باجتماع الناس في الصلاة على صعيد المسجد اجتماع الناس في المقام الأعظم بين يدي الله عز وجل في صعيد يوم القيامة ويرى إلى تفاضلهم في هذا المجتمع، فيتذكر به التفاضل الأكبر في الآخرة. قال الله تعالى: انظر كيف فضلنا بعضهم على بعض، وللآخرة أكبر درجات وأكبر تفضيلا. So you stop there, just translate that. So the Sheikh, he mentions beginning here, he mentions that it's from among the Sunnah that a person, before he leaves his house to go to this prayer of Eid, of Fitr, that he takes an odd amount of dates. So either he takes 3 dates or 5 or more than that, but as long as they're odd, so then he, as long as he keeps it, you know, an odd, so 3, 5, or before leaving the prayer. And the proof is the statement of Anas bin Malik, who said the Prophet ﷺ did not leave for the prayer on the day of Eid al-Fitr until he ate an odd number of days, and thus mentioned in Ahmad by Imam Bukhari. And then Tirmidhi. So then, yeah. And then the Prophet ﷺ used to leave walking, and he didn't used to go riding with an animal, or except for one who has an excuse, like a person who is lame or disabled, or because of someone the distance is far, and that's according to the proof is according to the statement of Ali ibn Abi Talib, may Allah be, have mercy upon him. We said from the Sunnah is to leave for the Eid walking, and that's mentioned by Tirmidhi, and you mentioned that it's a Hassan Sahih, it's a Hassan Hadith. Wa yusunnu li rajul, and it's also a Sunnah for them. So we mentioned odd number of dates, 3, 5, 7, or whatever, as long as they it's odd number of dates before you leave, and that's just to show that you're not fasting. Yeah, that's the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And also to go out walking, we mentioned that, and also it's a Sunnah for the man to beautify himself by wearing a beautiful garment, and it's mentioned in the Sahih Bukhari from Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with both of them, that he said Umar came with a thawb for the that he you know, that was from silk, yeah, and that was being sold in the marketplaces. So he came with it to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "O Messenger of Allah," he said to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "What is that?" He said, "O Messenger of Allah, imta," he said, "buy this to, you know, beautify with it for the Eid." And you know, don't with it on the day of Eid, and when the delegates visit, you know, when there's all the foreign delegates that visit. So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Innama hadhihi libasu man la khalaq lahu." So he said, "This is the dress of only those who do not have any portion of the hereafter." Yeah. So, and then. And the Sheikh mentioned that's because what? Not because it was somewhat beautiful, because it was silk. Yeah. And it's not permissible for the men to wear anything from silk or anything from gold, because them two are forbidden for the men from this ummah of this nation of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And that's mentioned in another hadith where the Prophet placed them two in his hand and he said, these two are forbidden for the men of this ummah. They are permissible for the women to wear silk and gold, but not for men. As for a man, woman, says, then the Sheikh mentions, as for a woman, then she goes out to the place, you know, as for a woman, then she must leave her home for the prayer with something, the dress that is not eye catching, without putting any perfume on, and without unveiling her body, because she's commanded to veil herself and is prohibited from displaying her beauty and from putting on perfume when going out. And there are narrations that, you know, corroborate that. And then she, so then the Muslim, he must perform the Eid prayer with tranquility and with full attention, and he should remember Allah, often invoking him, hoping for his mercy and fearing his punishment. One should remember the greatest sitting in front of Allah on the day of judgment. This should come to one's mind while he is gathered with the other Muslims for the Eid Salah, so with the people in the prayer area. Also consider that the difference in virtue amongst those in sitting there, and the even greater difference there will be in virtue in the hereafter. As Allah said, behold how we have exalted some of them over others in the present life, and surely the hereafter shall be greater in degree of in degrees of rank and greater in excellence. So that's Surah Al-Isra. Then the Sheikh, he mentions, وَلْيَكُنْ فَرْحًا بِنِعْمَةِ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ بِإِدْرَاكِ رَمَضَانَ وَعَمَلِ مَا تَيَسَّرَ فِيهِ مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ وَالصِّيَامِ وَالْقِرَاءَةِ وَالصَّدَقَةِ وَغَيْرِ ذَلِكَ مِنَ الطَّاعَاتِ فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. فَإِنَّ صِيَامَ رَمَضَانَ وقيامه إيمانا واحتسابا من أسباب مغفرة الذنوب والتخلص من الآثام. فالمؤمن يفرح بالإكمال الصوم والقيام لتخلصه به من الآثام، وضعيف الإيمان يفرح بإكمال تخلصه من الصيام الذي كان ثقيلا عليه ضائقا به صدره. والفرق بين الفرحين عظيم. So then the Sheikh, he said, and that you are that and that a Muslim is pleased and happy with Allah's blessings upon him, and by him reaching Ramadan, and by his actions and what Allah made easy for him in from Ramadan, from prayer, from fasting, from reading the Quran, and giving charity, and other than that, from the righteous actions and obediences that he carried out, and because in that is a lot of good in for him in the dunya. And the Sheikh, he quotes the Quran ayah, say all this is through the grace of Allah and through His mercy therein. Therefore, let them rejoice. That is better than what they hoard. So then the Sheikh, he said, indeed, fasting Ramadan and standing in the night prayer with faith and seeking the reward is from the reasons for forgiveness of the sins, and freeing him from sins, and for being forgiven. And is a means of gaining salvation from them as well. Therefore, the true believer is happy for completing his fast and his night prayer in order for him to be purified from his sins. So as for the one who's weak in faith, he's happy for the completion of Ramadan in order to be done with the fasting, which was hard upon him and heavy upon him, and a burden for him, a cause of uneasiness and discomfort in his heart. The difference between these two groups is huge. So the one who is pleased that his, that his fasts have been completed, so he can get the reward and his sins are forgiven and he's standing in night prayer and all the good righteous, while the other one, he just wants to happy that the month has come to an end, so he doesn't have to fast because it was a burden for him. Yeah? So it's hard for him. So the difference is clear. It's huge. So then the Sheikh, he mentions, he said, إخواني, my brothers, إنه وإن انقضى شهر رمضان فإن عمل المؤمن لا ينقضي قبل الموت. قال الله عز وجل واعبدوا ربك حتى يأتيك اليقين. وقال تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا مات العبد انقطع عمله. فلم يجعل لانقطاع العمل غاية إلا الموت. فلئن انقضى صيام شهر رمضان فإن المؤمن لن ينقطع من عبادة الصيام بذلك. فالصيام لا يزال مشروعا ولله الحمد في العام كله. ففي صحيح مسلم من حديث أبي أيوب الأنصاري رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: من صام رمضان ثم أتبعه ستا من شوال كان كصيام الدهر، وصيام ثلاثة أيام من كل شهر. قال فيها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: ثلاث من كل شهر ورمضان إلى رمضان، فهذا صيام الدهر كله. رواه أحمد ومسلم. وقال أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه: أوصاني خليلي صلى الله عليه وسلم بثلاث، وذكر منها الصيام ثلاثة أيام من كل شهر. والأولى أن تكون أيام البيض، وهي 13، 13 والرابع عشر والخامس عشر. لحديث أبي ذر رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: يا أبا ذر، إذا صمت من شهر ثلاثة فصم 13 وأربع عشرة وخمس عشرة. رواه أحمد والنسائي في صحيح. وفي صحيح مسلم أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سئل عن الصوم يوم عرفة، فقال: يكفر السنة الماضية والباقية. وسئل عن الصيام عاشوراء فقال: يكفر السنة الماضية. وسئل عن صوم يوم الاثنين فقال: ذاك يوم ولدت فيه ويوم بعثت فيه وأنزل علي فيه. وفي صحيح مسلم أيضا عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سئل أي صيام أفضل بعد شهر رمضان، قال: أفضل الصيام بعد شهر رمضان صيام شهر الله المحرم. وأوصى وأيضا وفي صحيحين عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت: ما رأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم استكمل شهرا قط إلا شهر رمضان، وما رأيته في شهر أكثر صياما منه في شعبان. وفي لفظ: كان يصوم إلا قليلا. وأنحى رضي الله عنها قالت: كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يتحرى صيام الاثنين والخميس. رواه الخمسة إلا أبا داود، فهو له من حديث أسامة بن زيد وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: تعرض الأعمال يوم الاثنين والخميس، خميس فأحب أن يعرض عملي وأنا صائم. رواه الترمذي. So we just translate that. So the Sheikh here, he said, my dear brothers, although the month of Ramadan is over, the believer's deeds must never end as long as he is alive. As Allah mentions, worship your Lord until certainty overtakes you, meaning death. And also Allah mentions, O you who believe, fear Allah as he deserves to be feared, and die not except in the state of Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ said, when the slave dies, his deeds will be cut off, come to an end. And the Prophet ﷺ has not placed an end to the deeds except with the arrival of death. Even though fasting the month of Ramadan is over, the believer will not stop fasting due to that. This is because fasting remains legislated throughout the year, and all praises to Allah for that. It is narrated by Ayyub al-Ansari, who said that the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever fasted the month of Ramadan then follows it up with 6 days of the month of Shawwal. He fasted six days of the month of Shawwal. And it is as if he has fasted the entire year, and that's collected by Muslim. So it's Sahih. And it's also mentioned that it's been also been legislated for us to fast 3 days in every month. and fasting 3 days in Hadith of the Prophet, fasting 3 days in every month, and fasting one Ramadan to another. This is like what the fasting of the entire year. That's collected by Ahmed and a Muslim. And Abu Huraira mentioned also, the Prophet advised me, my dear companion, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, my beloved, advised me with fasting 3. And he mentioned that they are the 3 days in every month. And is so they are the 3 days in every month. So that is the 3 days that are the light days that are fasted every month, and these are the 13th, 14th, and the 15th of every lunar calendar, and that's according to the hadith of Abu Dharr, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ya Abu Dharr, if you fast in a month, then fast that 3 days." The 13th, 14th, and the 15th of the lunar calendar. And that's mentioned by Ahmed and Nisa'i and in his Sahih. And it's also mentioned in Sahih Muslim that the Prophet ﷺ was asked about fasting the day of Arafah. He said it expiates the deeds of the year that preceded and the year that was coming. And he was asked about fasting the day of Ashura, and he said he experienced the year before it. And he was asked about fasting the day of the Monday, he said that is the day I was born, and that is the day I was sent as a prophet or messenger, and it is the day that the Quran was revealed to me. And he mentioned in Sahih Muslim also that Abu Huraira mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ was asked which of the fasts are the best after the month of Ramadan. He said that the best fasting after the month of Ramadan is the fasting of Muharram. Yeah, the fasting of Muharram. So there's a lot of fasting benefit there. We've got 6 more days of Shawwal coming. So you fast those, and the Shawwal is like fasting the whole of the year. So inshallah, bismillah, after Eid, we can benefit with that. And then they mention the 3 days of each month, 13, 14, and 15. We can all do that. Monday and Thursdays as well. And the day of Arafah and the day before it. The day of Arafah and the day of Ashura. The day of Muharram. Which is Ashura. And then in the Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, from the hadith of Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she said, I did not see the Prophet ﷺ complete a month of fasting except in Ramadan. And I did not see him have the most fasting other than that month, other than Sha'ban. And in another wording, he used to fast most of the month except a little of Sha'ban. And also from her, that may Allah be pleased with her, that she said that the Prophet used to fast Mondays and Tuesdays. I'm sorry, Monday and Thursdays. Yeah. So he used to fast Mondays and Tuesdays. So you seek out fasting Monday and Thursdays, and then and also Abu Huraira mentioned that the Prophet he would like his deeds to be the deeds are presented to Allah on Mondays and Thursdays. So I like to have my deeds presented to Allah while I'm fasting. So that shows the greatness of fasting Mondays and Thursdays. That's mentioned by At-Tirmidhi. Then the Sheikh, he says, وَلَئِنْ إِنْقَدَ قِيَامُ الشَّهْرِ رَمَدَانَ. So that was about fasting. So now we're going to talk about standing up on prayer at night. وَلَئِنْ إِنْقَدَ قِيَامُ الشَّهْرِ رَمَدَانَ. فإن القيام لا يزال مشروعا ولله الحمد في كل ليلة من ليالي السنة ثابتا من فعل الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم وقوله. ففي صحيح البخاري عن المغيرة بن شعبة رضي الله عنه قال: إن كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يقوم أو لا يصلي حتى ترم قدمه فيقال له فيقول أفلا فيقال له فيقول أفلا أكون عبدا شكورا. وعن عبد الله بن سلام رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: أيها الناس أفشوا السلام وأطعموا الطعام ووصلوا الأرحام وصلوا بالليل والناس نيام تدخل الجنة بالسلام. رواه الترمذي وقال حسن صحيح. وفي صحيح مسلم عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: أفضل الصلاة بعد الفريضة صلاة الليل. وصلاة الليل تشمل التتوّو كله والوتر، فيصلي مثنى مثنى، فإذا خشي الصبح صلى واحدة فأوترت ما صلى، وإن شاء صلى على صفة ما سبق في المجلس الرابع. وفي صحيحين عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: ينزل ربنا تبارك وتعالى كل ليلة إلى السماء الدنيا حين يبقى ثلث الليل الآخر، فيقول: من يدعوني فأستجيب له، من يسألني فأعطيه، من يستغفرني فاغفر له. والرواتب التابعة للفرائض 12 ركعة، 4 قبل الظهر وركعتين بعدها وركعتان بعد المغرب وركعتان بعد العشاء وركعتان قبل صلاة الفجر. فأنا أم حبيبة رضي الله عنها قالت: سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: ما من عبد مسلم يصلي لله تعالى كل يوم 12 ركعة تطوعا غير فريضة إلا بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة. وفي لفظ: من صلى 12 ركعة في يوم وليلة بني له بهن بيت في الجنة. رواه مسلم. So we're just going to translate that. And the Prophet, the Sheikh, he mentions here, so though the night prayer of the month of Ramadan, the Taraweeh, has it come to an end, that doesn't mean the night prayer that is legislated throughout the year, nights of the year, has come to an end. And all praises to Allah, as the hadith of the Prophet has been mentioned and established. From the statements and actions of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, that on the authority of Mughira bin Shu'bah, who said the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would stand at night in prayer until his feet would swell up, and it would be said to him, "Ease on yourself." He would just reply, "Well, shall I not be a grateful slave?" And that's mentioned by Bukhari. Yeah. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam meaning that he would stand up for the Tahajjud prayer throughout the year. And some of the scholars, like Sheikh Albani, mentioned that the Tahajjud prayer and the Qiyam, the light and night prayer, are one prayer, not different prayers. So Tahajjud and Taraweeh are one prayer. That's what Sheikh Albani mentioned. So the Prophet ﷺ would pray the night prayer throughout the year. And then Abdullah bin Salam, may Allah be pleased with him, mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ said, he said, "Oh people, spread the salam, feed the poor." So give salam to those, and there's another hadith, give salam to those you know and those you don't, to increase the love. So give salam to the Muslims, yeah, and feed the poor. Keep the ties of kinship with your relations, don't break them up. and pray the night prayer while the people are sleeping. You will enter paradise of your Lord with peace. And that's authentic by Sheikh Albani. And in Sahih Muslim, Abu Huraira mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ said the best salah after the obligatory five prayers is the night prayer, which is tahajjud. And the night prayer encompasses all of the voluntary prayers and the witr. So basically the two rak'ah prayers as well as the witr. So the hadith had mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ wouldn't go beyond 11 or 13 inside or outside of Ramadan, as Aisha radiallahu anha mentioned. So that is recommended. And he would pray them in two and two units until he feared that the Fajr prayer would come in, and then he would pray the one rakah for witr. So if you pray one wheels, he can pray as the way that has been described in the fourth sitting that the Sheikh we did it with these sittings. So the fourth sitting that was done by I think myself or Brother Sheikh. So you can refer back to that. But as I said, there's a hadith from the mother of the believers, Aisha radiallahu anha. She mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ will go beyond the 11 or 13 rak'ah inside or outside of Ramadan. And it's better to stick to the hadith that are, you know, established. And it's for the tahajjud. And it's also mentioned in Bukhari Muslim from Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah descends, the Lord descends, the Most High, he descends to the lowest heaven. He moved on to lowest heaven when only a third of the night remains, and he says, "Who will invoke me?" He said, "Who will invoke me? Who will make dua to me, so that I may answer his dua and who invocation? Who will ask me so that I'll give him what he asked for? And who will seek my forgiveness so that I may forgive him?" That's mentioned Bukhari Muslim. So here there's a few things that need to be established. First of all, that Allah is above the heavens, above his throne, and he descends. Because you don't descend from anywhere. You descend from a high place to a low place. That affirms Allah's being above. Yeah, that a lot of the people, the Muslims sadly in the state, deny that. So that's something that we affirm. And that Allah, he does that every night. And it's not restrictive to a time and place that we say Australia is this time, and some people start using their brains and so denying this, you know, and their brains are, you know, so limited. So they say, oh, you know, in Australia is this time, in America is that time. So Allah comes down every third of every night for every single person. Is Allah, you know, beholden to time and place? So Allah can do whatever he wills. So these people are, you know, they're limited, and they depend on their brain, which is very limited. And they don't rely upon the narrations, and they don't rely on the fact that Allah is able to do whatever he wills. So, yeah, so that's Bukhari Muslim, the two books, the most authentic books after the Quran. So they are Bukhari Muslim. So then it's also mentioned that the Sheikh mentions that prayers, the voluntary prayers, follow the obligatory prayers and are 12 units of prayer. So there are 12 sunnah prayers in a day. So there are four rak'ah. We mentioned this previously in one of the sittings. Four that are before the fard of the dhuhr. Yeah, four rak'ah. And two rak'ah after Zuhur, that's six altogether. And then two rak'ah after Maghrib, eight. And there's two rak'ah after Isha, that's 10. And then there's two rak'ah before Fajr, 12. So these are the 12 supererogatory prayers that a person should pray. And it's mentioned from, and the proof is mentioned of Habiba, may Allah be pleased with her, the wife of the Prophet, that she heard the Prophet say, whoever from the slave, from the slaves, or who is a Muslim, prays to Allah every day 12 prayers that are supererogatory, voluntary prayers that are not the obligatory prayers, except that Allah will build for him a house in Jannah. Allah will build for him a house in Jannah. And in another wording, whoever prays 12 rakahs in a day and night, and meaning these 12 rakahs, the Sabah Rakhshri, Allah will build for them a house in Jannah. And that's mentioned in Muslim as well. So it's authentic hadith. And then the Shaykh, he says, وَالذِّكْرُ أَدْبَارَ الصَّلَوَاتِ الْخَمْسِ أَمَرُ اللَّهُ بِهِ فِي كِتَابِهِ وَحَثَّ عَلَيْهِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فَإِذَا قَضَيْتُمُ الصَّلَوَاتَ فَإِذَا قَضَيْتُمُ الصَّلَاةَ فَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِكُمْ وَكَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِذَا سَلَّمَ اسْتَغْفَرَ ثَلَاثًا وَقَالَ اللَّهُمَّ أَنْتَ السَّلَامُ وَمِنْكَ السَّلَامُ تَبَارَكْتَ يَا ذَا الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ وَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَنْ سَبَّحَ اللَّهُ فِي دُبُرِ كُلِّ صَلَاةٍ ثَلَاثًا وثلاثين وحمد الله وحمد الله ثلاثا وثلاثين وكبر الله وكبر ثلاثا وثلاثين فتلك 99 ثم قال تمام المئة لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير غفرت خطاياه وإن كانت مثل زبد البحر. Rawahu Muslim. So then the Sheikh, he mentions as well from the other forms of prayer that are, you know, so for all the righteous deeds and worship is that the person that to make a zikr of Allah, to glorify Allah after each of the five obligatory prayers. So the Messenger encouraged us to do so. And Allah the Most High mentions, and when you have finished the prayer, remember Allah standing and sitting and laying on your sides. And when you are secure from danger, then observe prayer in the prescribed form. And verily prayer is enjoined on the believers to be performed at fixed hours. Yeah, the Surah Nisa. So whenever the Prophet ﷺ used to finish his prayer, he would ask Allah for forgiveness three times. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Well, yeah, so I seek refuge in Allah. So you do that three times. And that's from the completion of your prayer. So if there's any deficiency in your obligatory prayer, you say that three times. And then you say, what the Sheikh mentioned here, where did he mention it? There, yeah. Then he mentioned, Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. So he says, oh Allah, you are salam, i.e. the free from any deficiency. Wa minka salam, i.e. security is obtained from you. Glorified you are from all that they attribute to you, O owner of might and bounty. So we say that dua after every salah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, and that he praises Allah. He says, Subhanallah, 33 times. And he says, Alhamdulillah, 33 times. And he says, Allahu Akbar, 33 times. And he completes this to make 100 by saying, La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu lahul mulku lahul mulku wa lahul hamdu wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. And making that 100, and then all his sins will be, you know, that will be forgiven, the like of the foam of the ocean. Yeah. So even if they are the like the foam of the ocean. So that's what the Sheikh mentions. So then the Sheikh mentions, فَاجْتَحِدُوا إِخْوَانِي فِي فِعْلِ الطَّاعَاتِ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الْخَطَايَا وَالسَّيِّئَاتِ لِتَفُوزُوا بِالْحَيَاةِ الطَّيِّبَةِ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ وفي الدنيا والأجر الكثير بعد الممات. قال الله عز وجل من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فلنحيينه حياة طيبة ولا نجزينهم أجرهم بأحسن ما كانوا يعملون. اللهم ثبتنا على الإيمان والعمل الصالح، وأحيانا حياة طيبة، وألحقنا بالصالحين. والحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So there the Sheikh finished. So he just translate that. So then the Sheikh mentions, he says, "Oh my brothers, strive hard, you know, earnestly in doing good deeds, and stay away from sins and shortcomings. In all that, you will be successful with a pleasant life in this world, and with a great reward in the hereafter." Allah said, "Whosoever acts righteously, whether male or female, and is a believer, we will surely grant him a pure life, and we will surely bestow on such the reward according to the best of their works." So alhamdulillah, a good life in this life and the reward in the hereafter. And then the Sheikh makes a dua, and he finishes off with, "O Allah, help us be firm upon faith, righteous deeds, and grant us a pleasant life, and join us with the righteous. All praise belongs to Allah, the Lord of the world. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon the Prophet Muhammad, his family, and all his companions." So subhanAllah, we finish with that. Alhamdulillah and Jazakallah khairan for you know, listening to these and attending these benefits. Allah, you know, accept it from us all, and accept it from Brother Shaib and myself. And you know, Allah, make this month a month that we benefit in our deeds and our actions, and make it a month that has changed us for the better, where we don't return to sinning, and we don't return to you know, our previous ways. So you know, if as some of the Salaf would say, if a person, you know, if he was you know, a litmus test type of thing, would be that if a person is the same before Ramadan and after Ramadan, then that, you know, that is a sign that it's not been accepted. So Allah, make us from those who, you know, have changed for the better, and increase our iman, and keep us firm upon the deen, upon tawheed, and implementing the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, away from falling into shirk and bid'ah. And with that, inshallah, we finish. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. بارك الله فيكم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.